God gave me a message last night, and it's gonna be a hard message to preach. Because we've got so many people today. I don't know, they've laid down their armor. They just don't hear anymore how they live. God gave me this message yesterday. And we're just gonna do what God said. If it makes somebody mad, I ain't gonna apologize for it. Because it's God's word. And God's word will always stand. Amen. I'm gonna start out in the book of Matthew, chapter 10. Read through 6 through 9. Let everybody stand for reading God's word. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. So then they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. Let's turn over to Leviticus. Chapter 18, verse 22. Says, thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is abomination. Leviticus 20:13. Says, if a man also lie with mankind as he lieth with a woman, both of them committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death, and their blood shall be upon them. Now let's turn to 1 Corinthians, chapter 7. Verse 2, nevertheless, who avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Father, as we come to you this morning, God, I just pray, Lord, that this message would be a benefit of someone listening either by radio or by Facebook. Father God, I just pray that you would bless this message, Lord, and help me, Lord, to bring the message in the way that you'd have it to be brought out. I ask these things in the holy, precious name. Amen. Amen. A couple of weeks ago, my wife's sister had posted a post on Facebook, and it was somewhere along the line that if a preacher supports being gay or sex without being married, then he shouldn't be in the pulpit. And that's true. Now, we live in a time and an age where nobody has any morals anymore. Now, I'm not saying everybody, but the majority of this world has no morals anymore. And the first post on that, after that, is don't judge. Well, I'm going to tell you this morning, and I'm not judging. I'm going to let the Word of God be the judge. You cannot be a homosexual and make it into heaven unless you get saved and change your ways. If you're living with someone and you're not married, you'll not make it into heaven unless you get saved and change your ways. And if you take another man's wife or another woman's husband, you can't go to heaven unless you get saved and change your ways. Now, the reason I say unless you get saved, because I don't believe a Christian could do these immoral acts. If they're truly saved, they're not going to take another man's wife. They're not going to take another woman's husband. They're not going to run around and have a good time sexually, and they're not going to partake in homosexuality. But yet the world says, don't judge me. I'm not here to judge nobody. Because I can't. There's only one judge. And that's the Heavenly Father. And you will be judged by your actions on Judgment Day. I don't see how anybody can call themselves a Christian and then partaking in these sins. Unless the devil's just got them so deceived that they don't really know right from wrong. I guess a person can get in that state where they really don't know right from wrong. But the thing that irks me so bad is if you say anything about morals, the first thing they're going to do is don't judge. I'm not judging. I'm reading the Word of God. And I'm making a statement that if you're homosexual or you're living with somebody or if you took another man's wife or another woman's husband, that's an abomination in God. That's a fact. That's not good. The Bible plainly says, now, there's more sin than just those three things. I mean, we sin every day. We're supposed to go to God every day and repent of what we've done wrong. Even if we don't realize we've done anything wrong, we need to repent daily. The Bible commands us to do that. Now, I don't want any embarrass nobody, so I'm gonna use myself. If I was to go out and be with another woman every night of the week, and then come to church and try to preach to y'all, I expect this church to throw me out. I'm serious. If I was to do that, I am not fit to be a pastor. And if anybody ever comes here that does that, me being the pastor, I'll ask them to leave. I'll talk to them first. I'll counsel with them. If they don't change their ways, they're not welcome. Because that's what tires the church up, if we allow that to go on in the church. Amen? I've seen it. I've been to church before this has happened. And it tires the church down when somebody's fooling with somebody else's wife, or somebody else's husband. And if the pastor don't have the guts to do something about it, he's going to turn the church all to it. I mean, I believe that anybody can be forgiven. But if they don't want to be forgiven and they don't want to change their ways, they're not well. But if they'll get down on their knees and cry out to God for forgiveness and then change their ways, they're welcome. Anybody can make a mistake. Amen. But, like I say, as long as I'm pastor, this stuff ain't going to go on. I have no inkling that anything is. I mean, I have no idea what anything is. I believe everybody here is what they say they are. Now, I've said this many times. Nobody knows your heart but you and God. But I believe, I don't know, but I believe with all my heart that everybody here is where they need to be with God. And let's keep it that way. And the church is growing a little, and I like it when the church grows slow. Because when the church grows fast, you're going to have trouble. And as long as the church is growing slow, good morning.
Good morning.
As long as the church is growing slow, like it is, I don't think we're going to have any problems. Amen. We all need to watch what we're doing, watch what we're saying at all times. You know, words can hurt just like a two-edged sword. And I believe that what we are on Sunday morning, it's what we need to be on Sunday evening, all day Monday, all day Tuesday, all day Wednesday, all day Thursday, all day Friday, and all day Saturday. I've seen people, they come to church and shout the house down. And you meet them in town or somewhere during the week and they're cussing like crazy. How can a person be like that? Either they love God or they don't. And if they're going to use his name in vain and cuss like a sailor, they don't love God. They're putting on a show for everybody on Sunday morning. Amen? what it amounts to. But the thing that irks me the most is you post something about living right or not living right, and the first post on that post is going to be, "That's dead to me." And right there tells you you're guilty. Because if they're living right, they're supposed to be amen. It would be, "Don't judge me." I've got a niece that's out in sin. And it don't matter what you post, if it's anything about Christianity, "Don't judge me." I'm not the judge. But there's one thing about it. You will be judged on Judgment Day. And every knee shall bow and confess Jesus is Lord. You could preach to you and you couldn't talk. And there'd be somebody out there, "Don't judge me." Because they know they're wrong, but they don't want to change. But a person that's doing wrong changes, asks God into their heart. You know, I've often heard preachers say the best Christians are usually the ones that were the loudest when they were lost. And I think there's a lot of truth to that. I mean, I never was real rowdy. I got into things I shouldn't have got into. But I wasn't a bad person. I was always raised in church. I thought I got saved when I was about 8 years old, but then I found out when I was about 25, 26, and I'd never been saved. When you get saved, you got to pray to God. You can't let somebody else do praying for you. And that's what I done when I went up to the altar the first time. I was under conviction. But the preacher said the prayer. And when I got up, he said, "You're saved." And a kid ain't going to know the difference. You know, if they ain't been saved, they ain't going to know the difference. Because they've not been taught enough. But as time went on, I realized that I didn't have what everybody else had. I didn't have the joy in my life. I wouldn't say that I was unhappy, but I wasn't happy. Then God spoke to me one night in revival. Didn't nobody come to me and leave me up like it was the first time. And I realized that I needed God. And I wanted to have what all these other people had. I wanted to feel something. I went up. I knelt down and I prayed. And I told God, I realized I was a sinner. And I didn't want to die and go to heaven. And I asked him to come into my heart. And he did. When I got up, I shouted all over the house. I had something I never had before. I had that peace and that joy. Had that happiness. And that's what it's all about. But then again, when we get saved, we can't just sit there You need to be doing something for God. God will give us that want to. If we're saved, God will give us that want to. I believe that every person gets saved as a calling on their life. It may be coming in and claiming the church wants you to live. It may be the song leader. It may be a Sunday school teacher. But God gives everybody a calling. It ain't nothing but being a witness. That's important. Being a witness. How many times do we meet people in town talk about the Lord? I'm the world's worst myself when I meet somebody like I did broke down on this morning. We'll talk cold, baby. Boy, too. We ought to be talking about the Lord, baby. If we just really what we need to be, we'll be talking about the Lord. That shows I'm not perfect. I'm human. I make mistakes. First thing out of my morning, out of my mouth when I met Daniel this morning, man, ain't it a beautiful day. Ain't we blessed to be able to get up and come to church. Something like that. That's what needs to be on our hearts and on our minds 24 hours a day. It's how God has blessed us. Share your blessings with other people. You know, somebody may be going through a hard time financially or may have lost a loved one. You never know when you meet somebody what they're going through. Give them a smile. Say, may God give it. He's blessed us with another day. I know he's good to me. He even blesses me when I'm asleep, because I sleep like a baby anymore. Freight train is running through my trailer during the night. I don't think I'd ever know it because I sleep so hard. God blesses me with good sleep. I know other people that, you know, they say, well, I can't sleep at night. I'm just tossing and turning. I have one of them nights every now and then. Majority of the time, I'm in a good heart of sleep, and nothing wakes me up. I think that might be breaking in my house, and I didn't know it. But I got faith in God that if somebody does break in my house, he'll let me hear it. I got enough faith in God that he'll put a head of protection around the house before nobody else got to break in. And if we're true to God and try our very best to serve him with all of our ability, I believe that he will. He'll keep us safe and harmed. I have no doubt about that. Andy worries all the time that her cancer can come back. I told her, I said, man, if you're living in dark pain, just take care of it. You don't have to worry. She went to the cancer doctor Thursday. Had a real good report. Now she only has to go every 6 months instead of 3 months. God's taking care of it. He's got his hands on it. And I had a pretty good report this week when I went to the doctor with the sugar out of whack again. But that's just something I've got to run a little bit. All the time, I have three different boys. I just thank God I made it to be here. Thank God for what he's done for me. He's never, ever failed me. I've never asked God for anything. He may not answer it the way I wanted him to, but he answered. You know, sometimes we let our wants get in the way of our needs. I mean, I've said it before. I'd like to drive around in a big Cadillac. I love them cars. But God knows I don't need it. But if I needed it, I'd have it. Amen. My old car out there turned over 100,000 miles a couple of weeks ago. She still running? The only thing I've ever done to that car was put a ball bearing in the front. Put tires on. I don't think there's been a wrench on the motor ever. Except to change them all. That's a blessing. That's a blessing from God. We all need to examine our hearts every day. We get down on our knees and say, God, I failed you today. Somewhere, somehow, I failed you today. God, please forgive me. If you know that you failed, then mention that sin. Say, God, forgive me. Lord, I said some words I shouldn't have said today. Or, Lord, I had some evil thoughts today. Whatever. Ask you to forgive me. Mention your sin. God is a loving God, and he's a forgiving God. As long as we are trying to stay on the straight and narrow pathway. Thank God every day for your blessing. God showed me the other day that when things don't turn out exactly like we want it to, we should still try to see the silver lining. Now, something good is going to come out of it. It may not have went the way we wanted it to. Something good is going to come out of it. You know, a pastor has a hard job. There's a lot of times I get discouraged. And I have to get down on my knees. And make God reassure me that I'm where he wants me to be. And that I'm doing what he wants me to do. And all that is Satan trying to discourage me. Trying to get me to quit, because that's his job. As long as I'm serving God, he'll be on my back. I just got to turn around and shake him off. And step right back into the right track. And I'm sure there's nobody here that don't have the same problem. Not to get us on Satan will get us on our back, and he'll try his best to get us quit, give up. All we gotta do is shake him off. thing you got to do is tell Satan, you know what his ending is. And it ain't a very good ending for Satan. We've been studying over Revelation, man. It is awesome what God brought to us. We get realized. I mean, if you'll get the Bible and study it, God will show you things you don't understand. Now, I'm not saying God's going to show us everything, because I believe there are mysteries in the Bible that are meant to be mysteries. It'll be revealed. Amen. This is the message. A little shorter than what I thought it would be, but this is what God did.